welcome. My name is Jana Benge, and I'm on the Kerouac board, and we have several members of the Kerouac board here. So on behalf of everyone, I'd like to welcome you, and we have, raise your hand if you're on the board, Karen, Naomi, Jeff, and someone I don't know, but you know, what the heck? Welcome to the board. Yeah, probably a really good addition.
I'm a new board member.
Yeah, sort of how we get our board members, really. Well, for those of you, and I think there's a lot of new faces here who don't know, I'm the Kerouac House. This is where Jack Kerouac lived in 1958. He actually lived in the back part. This is a bit posh for him, really. But you're welcome to ask any of the board members to give you a tour afterwards, and you can sit in the chair that Jack sat in if that's going to be exciting for you. We have had it professionally cleaned, which is really a good thing. And we have four residents a year. We have an open application process. Anybody can apply, whether they have an MFA or have just written in their bedroom in their journal, whatever. It's on the strength of their writing, and we choose four residents a year. We bring them here. We give them a food stipend, give them the house to and then they do what they will with it. Hopefully they use the time to produce some writing, to get something straight in their head, whatever. And we actually require very little of them. One thing we do require is that they give us a final reading and share with the community what they've been up to. So this time we have JC, and he is going to be featured tonight. He's very excited about that. And he's told me that he has, I put my glasses on, got most of the way through a new draft of his memoir. And is that what you're going to be reading tonight, JC? Awesome. I'm very excited for it. And also come up with a new idea for a book, because when you've got nothing to do 24/7 except think about books. Now, he says, I quote you, it's on feedback and reverb, how the science of sound can help create social change, an encyclical on injustice. So, hey, we're having a question and answer at the end, and if you'd like to know more, you can just ask him. I asked him what has surprised him most, and he gave the same answer that I swear every single person in the last 3 years has given, and that is the vibrancy of the Orlando literary scene and how much it has evolved. So that's kudos to everybody here. We're all corporately part of that, and it does surprise people. They think we just, I don't know, we are Mickey Mouse ears and I don't know, ride roller coasters, but there's more to us than that. I asked him also what he's taking away from here, and he said that it's given him a confidence shot in the arm to have been selected and to have been given so much time to pursue his art. So he is on his way back to Seattle after this and will be submitting his new draft and hopefully find a publisher and be on the New York Times bestseller list soon. So now he's going to read to us, and then we have a little Q&A, and then you can hang out. So welcome, JC.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming tonight. It's really full in here, and I am happy to host all of you, and also only the slightest bit nervous. I'm very excited, and before I get started, I would like to, thank you, Genevieve, I would like to just take a minute and talk and say how much I've enjoyed my time here. It's been really incredible. I started the book that I revised while I was here almost 10 years ago in this room. I was doing a workshop with the writer-in-resident Liza Monroy and Elise Kuznets from Valencia Community College. And I was in my second semester of community college and my second writing workshop ever. And Elise had brokered a deal where we would host our weekly writing workshops here at the house. And Liza gave me a writing prompt that started me on the path I've been on for a very long time. And it was teachers at Valencia College that recommended that I pursue Emerson College and wrote a letter of recommendation. And that was where I went to pursue my BA, and someone there turned me on to Goddard. And so it was a domino effect from being here so long ago. And so it's been really cool to come back full circle after all that time, and to return and see how much the Orlando literary scene has grown since I've been gone has really been a pleasure. When I left, it was burgeoning. It was nascent. But to come back and see podcasts and to see so many people, Vanessa Blakeslee and Kate McGowan and Elise Kuznets and Brian Turner all have new books out, to see John King's podcast, to see the radio show with Functionally Literate. And it's been just really great. I've been super proud of my hometown. And it's been really great to be back around friends and to be a part of this community again for a little while. And I hope maybe one day I'll return, maybe to teach or just pass through again on a reading tour. But I've had a chance to spend time with a lot of wonderful people while I've been here that have given me a lot of cause to reflect on what I've been working on, the new stuff. And it's been really amazing. I've met some of the young talent here, and I'm really excited for them and for what's next. And just as on a personal note, I got a chance to spend time with a lot of old friends, and that was really great. So this entire process for me hasn't just been about writing. It's sort of been a homecoming, and it's been a really great chance to reconnect with my roots. So thank you all for that chance. I want to personally apologize to Thor. Yes, that will. That's what I'm taking away. The reading was rescheduled because the Miami Book Fair was last week, and there were so many wonderful people in the Orlando literary community that couldn't attend because they were at the book fair doing amazing things. And so I kindly asked Karen Price and Summer Rodman if we could reschedule, and they graciously said, yeah, that's fine. And but they forgot to sell Thor. And so I had just returned from a walk where it started raining because it's Florida, and I was soaked and in PJs, and Thor walked in the front door for the reading, much like that. Welcome, Brett. Good timing. While I was sitting here in my PJs. And I promptly screamed at him. And for that, I feel very badly. I don't feel bad. I feel bad. But I, you know, I'm lucky that I let Florida's stand your ground law is. Thank you for being a good support, Thor. So this evening I have a few readings for you. I heard the last writer who was here intimidates me. She was very prolific. So it felt like a bit of a challenge that I wanted to keep pace with her. So I prepared a very long reading for this evening because I heard the last time she went like an hour and a half. I think you guys can do more. You have more patience than that. You have stamina. You have vigor. No, okay. So we're not going to go through all this. I have a lot of pages X'd out. But so I brought a few short things and then one longer thing, and you're free to cut me off at any point. Now, done. I'm fine with that. Thank you, Peter. So we're going to do like a sine wave, like down, like down, up, down, if that's cool. Is that all right? Okay. So this piece is from the middle of the memoir. It's like page 360-ish, and some background. When I was 13, I was kidnapped out of an airport in Las Vegas, and then I was put in a mental institution in St. George, Utah, where I spent a little while, and then I was shipped to a behavior modification program in Upolu, Western Samoa, in the South Pacific. This is part of what's called the troubled teen industry. It's a billion-dollar network of privatized prison camps for kids, where for the cost of an Ivy League education, you too can outsource your child abuse. I say kidnapped because it was very much against my will, but my mother paid the people who did this to me, and a lot of kids get taken out of their bed in the middle of the night. I was taken from an airport parking garage. And after I spent a little bit of time in this place in Utah where, you know, I had my head shaved and I got lots of vaccinations and immunizations and a passport so I could leave the country, and they medicated me, that place was later shut down because they found out that all the patient charts were identical. They, like, all the kids were just given trazodone and Ritalin, and they all were diagnosed the same. And, I was shipped to this program in Samoa. It's called Paradise Cove. Yeah, they all have. I know, right? They all have these wonderfully innocuous names. They sound like retirement resorts or like celebrity spas or rehabs, like Tranquility Bay and Casa by the Sea. So, Paradise Cove was basically just a prison camp. And when I first got there, I was in a compound in the mountains surrounded by barbed wire. But later we went to a beach, and the beach was, you know, less barbed wire, but, you know, more ocean. So that's kind of the functional barrier there. And the program was run by a guy named Robert Litchfield, who is also notable for being the co-finance chair of Mitt Romney during his first run at the U.S. presidency. And they caught some bad press, and so they weren't working together anymore, but they still... So when Rolling Stone asked Ann Romney what her cause would be as first lady, she answered, "I'd really like to work with troubled teens." So that's our country. The troubled teen industry actually began in the 1970s. A guy named Mel Sembler was very famous for starting a company called Straight Incorporated. And that was a residential treatment program that was endorsed by Ronald and Nancy Reagan and George and Barbara Bush as part of the DARE program and the war on drugs. And so now, you know, several years later, we're finally, hey, come on, I guess. What's up, George? Oh, what? One more. Hey. What? Welcome. So, something 45 years later, we're realizing, like, the war on drugs was much like the war on terror, as effective as a war on jealousy. That's a David Cross bit. I can't tell you. Yeah. So is it basically that the most powerful politicians in our country have been profiting off the abuse and neglect of children for many, many years. So I wrote a book about my experience, and the program I was in, I was there for 2 years, and this place was worse, I would say, than an American prison, because you had no access to any sort of communication with the outside world, and you had absolutely no access to abuse reporting of any kind. There was a lot of torture and brainwashing, and we had to go through something called seminars. And the seminars was where we received the programming. It was called a program for a reason. And those seminars were run by a guy named David Gilcrease. David Gilcrease was trained by a man named Warner Earhart. Warner Earhart started the Earhart Seminar Training Series. You guys heard of EST? EST, yeah. That went on to become the Landmark Forum. If any of you are into business, hey, I'm just keeping up time for the stragglers. That's all. Hey. Welcome, Ashley. Hi, Ashley. So the Earhart Seminar Training Center series was part of the Human Potential Movement in the 1970s, and that was... where this technology came from. But the man, Warner Earhart, he actually learned these technologies from a dude named Robert Lifton. Robert Lifton worked for the CIA. Project called MKUltra. Heard of it? Yeah. This was where we reverse engineered the steps of brainwashing from American POWs that had returned from the Korean War that had been brainwashed by the Chinese. So they decided to do it to kids. Yes, please. Yeah.
People are claiming that kids on Disney and Nickelodeon TV shows have been brainwashed by MK Ultra. I'm not saying it's true. I'm just saying that it's supposedly out there more than just
Sure. Thank you. I don't know personally any of the kids who work for Disney, but I do know, a thousand or so others that were with me in this place. And so the first seminar I ever went through was with David Gilcrease. He was especially vile. But the next seminar, this is the first one's called Discovery, but the second one is called Focus. This section is called is from Focus, and the seminar facilitator was a woman called Lou Dozier, and you're welcome to look her up online. She's still around running seminars for adults now, and wonderful lady. I don't know what vocabulary will come up in this section, but just so you know, the families there, the units of boys, groups of like 10 to 15, they were called families. And your supervisor was called a father. That was a Samoan dude. And the older white kids who had been there a while, they were referred to as staff, but they're like semi-staff. They're level fours. I've been in the program a while now, and I am in a seminar with Lou Dozier. And these were 4-day ordeals where there was a lot of sleep deprivation and dehydration and supersaturation of information, total milieu control, to induce what psychologists call the unfreezing phase, which is a state where you are psychologically pliable and receptive to new belief systems. This is a couple days into the first, second seminar. The next day, besides lectures and charts, is full of games and exercises that are designed, like Discovery, to be no-win scenarios, no-choice choices. Basically, no matter what we do, we get berated by Lou and the staff, usually with a barrage of questions we're not meant to answer. How is that a mirror for your life? Why do you hate yourself? Why do you sabotage yourself? Sometimes questions are traps to force you into demeaning yourself. Answer yes or no. Are you ready to stop hating yourself? Answer yes or no. Are you going to stop lying to yourself? There's a game of freeze tag, which game's point I do not understand and so keep getting yelled at. Then we do an exercise Lou calls giver taker, where we have to form a circle and go around looking at each other in the eyes, labeling each other giver or taker. And then at the end, Lou walks around screaming taker in each of our faces, lectures us about how much we take from our parents and take from the program. When we come back from dinner, all the chairs are gone. And at first, I think we're going to go apeshit with the towels again. I'll tell you about that later. But instead, Lou has us all lie down on the floor and close our eyes, and the lights dim some and spa music comes on, and she leads us in some guided meditation. You're on a cruise. Her voice is soft, soothing now. You're on the most luxurious ship you can imagine, far out at sea on a crystal clear night. And on this cruise, you're reunited with all your friends and family. They're all here. Everyone happy to be together, no tension, no drama. You're all enjoying each other's company on a warm, cloudless night. She spends something like half an hour describing this idyllic voyage, speaking gently, lulling us into a relaxing visualization. And after you've eaten a decadent meal and spent time on the deck talking with everyone, you go to your cabin for the night feeling warm and loved and safe as you climb into your soft bed and sink down into the comfy mattress. And you're lying there warm and comfortable in your bed when the room explodes with loud banging and bellowing. The staff are picking up and slamming down tables, beating chairs into the floor, screaming bloody murder. And now Lou is loud and her voice is angry and menacing. Your ship has hit an iceberg and you are going down. We've all shot bolt upright, startled and confused. The ship is sinking, and there aren't enough lifeboats to fit everyone. Lou tells us that we're going down in shark-infested waters, and since there's not enough space in the lifeboats, we have to decide who lives and who dies. You'll each have 1 minute to make your case for why you deserve to live, after which we're supposed to proceed around the standing circle again, one at a time, looking each boy in the eye and casting a vote for whether he lives or dies. We're allotted only 2 live votes. Each, though, and each time you cast one, the person you give it to is supposed to yell their name lives, so the staff can keep track of who's going to live and who's going to die. Boys each take turns standing on a chair at the front of the room defending their right to live. Lou and the staff take notes. Some boys use their time to talk about how great they are and how they plan to do good things with their lives. Some kids say they deserve to live because they're good and they have family who loves them. Some kids are scared and quiet and don't try very hard. Some kids admit outright they don't think they deserve to live. There's no clock for us to time ourselves, so some kids don't use up near a whole minute while other kids get cut off when Lou yells, "Time's up." When it's my turn, I say I want to live. I believe that I deserve to live, but I honestly don't think I have any more of a right to live than anyone else here, that we're all entitled to live, which part of me honestly believes, but mostly I say it because I'm trying to cover my bases and earn some live votes for being altruistic. Another part of me thinks, fuck these people. These other boys should all die, all of them. I should live. Me, I'm smarter, and I will contribute more to the world. Plus, I really haven't gotten to live yet. Reed lost my virginity. I keep this to myself. When I've said what I have to say, but I realize I have a little more time left, I say, but maybe we could find some way to work together so we don't all have to die. Like, maybe we can grab life preservers for the people that won't fit in the lifeboats and put out a mayday. The sharks can't eat everyone, and Lou screams, "That is not in the parameters of this exercise. Time's up." We keep going until everyone has had a turn on the chair, all 50 or 60 of us. Then Lou and the staff give us feedback. If a kid didn't use up his entire minute, Lou or the staff shout something like, "Why do you think so little of yourself that you don't even use the whole time allotted to argue for your life?" Or, "Is your life not worth a minute of your time?" Or, "Do you hate yourself so much that you can't even be bothered to argue for your life? Do you think you deserve to die?" But if a boy got time's up called on him, then they tear into him for being holier than thou and for having a better than complex. How is that a reflection of your selfishness? I get chewed out for both. Plus, Lou yells at me for thinking I'm a special case, for trying to bend the rules, to manipulate. How is that a mirror for my life? Then we go around the folly in a circle for hours, telling each other to die. You look a kid in the eyes, a boy you know from your family or your beach, a boy you've seen cry, a boy you've played volleyball with or cards with, a boy who gave you his leftover rice, a dirty boy covered in rashes standing there in mildewed skirt. You look him square in the eye and you say, "You die." And the whole time the staff is behind you shouting louder, shouting, "I can't hear you." And you have to say the person's name, too. So when I come in front of Josh Driggers, I have to look him in the eyes and shout, "Josh, you die." Someone asks Lou, "What if we don't know someone's name?" And she says, "Then you say, I don't care enough about you to know your name. You die." And so there's a whole room full of sobbing boys telling each other they don't care, telling each other to die. Every time a boy looks at you in the eyes and shouts, "You die," you do a little. You die inside. And every time you tell someone else to die, they do, and you see it, and so you die too. Every once in a while, someone will shout, "Joey lives," or "Ryan lives." And part of you thinks, "Fuck Joey." And part of you thinks, "Good, I'm glad someone will live." More and more, it's the same kids shouting out that they live, the kids everyone likes, the kids who are family leaders, the popular kids. How is that a mirror? I come up to John Dabo. John, who is small like me and always in trouble and always getting picked on for being a crap puller. John, who I was in love family with back in Lake Tiara. I look at him standing there, his eyes all red and watery, and I've already killed so many people tonight, and I don't have it in me, so I say, "John, you live." And it barely registers on his face, and so I say it again, "John, you live." And his eyes get a little wider, and he lifts his head and says, "John lives." But not loud enough because a staffer shouts, "I can't hear you. Do you not care about your own life to speak up?" And then Lou jumps on him with, "How many times in your life have you let yourself die instead of speaking up? How many times do you let others talk right over you? Do you really want to die because you don't care enough about yourself to speak loud enough to be heard?" And so I'm wishing that I wouldn't have bothered because I've only made it worse for him. But he shouts, "John lives." And Lou and the staffers move on. Lou stands in the center screaming, "Vote." And kids shout, "You die." And then she yells, "Step left, another missed opportunity," over and over. "Vote, you die, step left. Vote, you die, step left." Some kids double over with tears, slump to the ground, but the staff jerk them up, force them to keep killing, to keep dying. Lou shouts, "Step left. The person you are now facing is your parent. Are you going to tell them to die like you did so many times at home? Do you even have a live vote left? Or have you used them both already? Go ahead, tell your parents to die again." And she shrieks, "Vote," and kids scream, "Die," at their parents, and a collective wail of sorrow rips through the room, a wave of tears. I scream, "Mom, you die." Lou screams, "Step left," screams, "How many people have you told to die in your life? How many people do you tell to die every day?" Screams, "Who does this next person represent to you? Who else have you told to die? Your friends, your brother, your sister?" And the kids start sobbing louder, and she screeches, "Vote," And we answered, you die. Because I told my mother to die, I still have one vote left. I'm saving it for Jerry because he's in my family, because he's nice to me, and I like him a lot. Because I wouldn't mind it if he was my older brother. Because I can't bear to see him every day after this if I tell him to die. But Jerry gets to me first, and he looks me in the eyes and says, Sevcik, you die. And his eyes say, I'm sorry, I used up my votes already, but it still cuts me in half. I give him my last vote anyway. I don't get a single live vote, not one. And I want to die, I really do. It's been hours and everyone is wet-faced and exhausted, looking and Lou shouts, so how many of you saved one of your live votes for yourself? Only a few kids raise their hands. Since you don't have any votes left, the rest of you have to vote yourselves to die, she says, and we all fall silent, put our heads down. Now, do it. She screams, and everyone who doesn't have a vote left shouts his own name, tells himself to die, and the room heaves in one giant sob again as Lou is shouting, how is this a mirror for your life? How often do you tell yourself to die? And then Lou is dimming the lights, telling us to lie down, to close our eyes, asking us to focus on how we feel right now. The staff is going around handing out the duct tape towels, and Lou is still talking, but I don't even hear her. I'm just waiting for what happens next. For our cue to let go. And then it comes and the folly erupts and we all spend whatever's left of our energy beating the ever-loving snot out of the floor with the rolled up towels, bellowing our rage at no one but everyone, at nothing and everything, at ourselves and our parents and this place and each other, just unloading every last ounce of anguish and anger while we're allowed to show it, scream crying and thrashing until there's nothing left. End section. You guys can live. That was just a little section of one of these seminars we had to go through on the regular, like monthly. And they had this philosophy of like break you down, build you back up, break you down, build you back up. And mirrors kind of an abusive relationship a lot. The goal with a book is to try to bring this to light because not a lot of people know that these places exist, let alone what happens in them. They remain a totally unregulated industry. Our government is generally the people in power, the politicians are the ones profiting from this industry, so it still remains absolutely, it has no government oversight. So schools, if they are considered therapeutic or religious, aren't subject to the same regulations that normal institutions are subject to. My hope is that the book will garner some attention that could affect legislation.
What made you realize that you wouldn't be brainwashed?
I don't want to sound like a dick, but people who have a higher IQ are less susceptible to brainwashing. And I wasn't buying it, and that got me in a lot of trouble, actually. Because I didn't comply. I don't think that it was something I was very young, 13 when I went there. But it was, it wasn't that I realized it at the time. It was much later that I realized it. I'll tell you that story during the Q&A if you want. We'll keep the reading going. I have two more things I can read tonight. One is while I was here in town, I got published in your local rag, the Orlando Weekly. Yay! Hey, so thank you. I call every paper a rag. Don't this not as well. That's like a fiction piece, and it's short and it's funny. So I can do that now, or I could do another section from the book and do that at the end. So, what do you guys? More what? End on the happy one? But neither of them are happy. I said funny. I didn't say happy. Okay. I'll save the Orlando Weekly for last. This is more from the program, and it is about another 100 pages into the book. So this is the section where I had to get my infected toenail ripped out in a third world country in the middle of the South Pacific.
Hey. Can you ask if anyone else has had that experience? Show of hands.
Show of hands. So we had to we had the same schedule every day over and over, and it was kind of like a from the time you wake up till the time you go to bed, a rigorous schedule of torture and abuse with sporadic like exercise, which is meant as torture, and education, which there are no actual teachers there. Nurses are just Samoan ladies. They're not actually qualified in any way to be nurses. We all wear like flip-flops that are just worn through and sometimes barefoot on a beach with lots of coral. There's a lot of malnutrition. And because we have to exercise so much, it gets exacerbated because we just don't have the nutrition to keep up with our energy expenditure. So anyway, here we go. Days blend together and fall away, lost in the routine of our schedule. My body is finally starting to give in to the inadequate nutrition and poor hygiene, the constant pounding of twice daily skills and humidity and salt water. I don't know how it's held out this long, probably because I'm only just starting to go through puberty, just starting to really sweat. I still haven't gotten the scabies or the ringworm most boys are plagued by, but I've started a respectable collection of small boils. Nothing like the monsters I've seen of some of the kids, but still painful to pop and drain, difficult to keep clean. I've also begun cultivating some good old-fashioned crotch rot, the kind you might get from walking around an amusement park all day in jeans in the middle of the summer, but being from Florida, I can cope. What's worse, though, is that the constant running up and down the beach and the sand and coral has caused me to develop incredibly painful and infected ingrown toenails on both sides of the large toes of each foot. The right big toe is manageable as long as I keep pulling the toenail back and cleaning the sand out, but the left is swollen and red and raw, a little meatball of my own inflamed flesh on either side of the toenail that constantly oozes a dark yellow pus, a pus that collects dirt and sand and dries to form a hardened crust I have to peel off to clean, which act makes the wound open fresh again and begin seeping. The first few times I have to go to the nurse about them, she makes it clear that I'm wasting her time, shooes me away. When I persist, she tells me to wash them in the ocean and wrap them in fabric to keep them clean. But I have nothing to wrap them in, so I tear up my blue lava-lava, which is a skirt, from when I was on level 2, because I don't see that happening again soon. The wrappings are a pain in the ass to tie, come off constantly, except when they stick to the dry pus and do nothing to keep the sand out. Skills is already torture, and now it's nearly unbearable. Just walking hurts, but when I'm forced to run or do jumping jacks or up-downs, every heavy footfall sends a wave of excruciating pain through my toe all the way up to my groin into my gut. My feet throb. My toes have a pulse. Dwayne Lee visits the beach for one of his walkthroughs. Dwayne is some sort of assistant director here, right below Brian Vaifanua. Dwayne's known for being an absolute hard-ass, zero compassion. He's half Samoan, and it looks like the other half is Asian. He has a shaved head and squinty eyes, and he's always in Dwayne Lee uniform of black mesh shorts and a black tank top, always wearing dark black sunglasses, always walking around like there's someone whose ass he's been meaning to kick, if only he could remember whom. And I have the audacity to speak directly to the man when I see him in the school folly. I show him my toes and say, "The nurse won't do anything about these." I've learned the nurses here aren't actual nurses. They're just Samoan ladies who get paid not much to hand out kids' prescriptions and Panadol and the occasional Band-Aid. And if you look like you're dying, they might make you a doctor's appointment, but you better be really sure you're dying. A kid named Bill Boyles got electrocuted when he touched chicken wire that was shorting out with some exposed electrical wiring of a transformer on the outside of one of the follies with lights strung up. I wasn't there. I just heard the story. He had a full-on seizure and got slammed into a retaining wall. They waited hours before they took him to the hospital, and apparently he was lucky to be alive. The electric current in Samoa is 240, 60 AC. So, kid got zapped. "Well, what do you want me to do?" Joanne asks. "I don't know. Something? They really hurt. Like, it just hurts to walk. You should just shove a Q-tip underneath the nail so it stops growing in, and don't cut it so close," he says as he turns his back on me and walks away. So, I'm going to skip this next part, which is about one of our punishments So a standard punishment there, if you break an important rule, is getting hogtied with your hands and feet behind your back and locked in a box called isolation for 3 days. But if it's like a minor rule, like talking without permission, you just have to go to the worksheet room where you sit cross-legged on a concrete floor. Have you ever like been made to kneel on rice? Did anybody have Asian grandparents? It's kind of like that because there's a lot of sand on the floor and you have to keep your back straight and you listen to these tapes and then you would have to test out of the tapes. And the tapes are on historical figures. So there's a little section where I learn about like a lot of classical composers and get the foundations for Buddhism on a tape about Siddhartha Gautama. And so the next time I see Dwayne on the beach, I get permission from my father to go talk to him. Dwayne, Mr. Civic, he looks like the Polynesian version of the Terminator. I tried the Q-tip thing like you said, but it didn't help. They're already too deep and infected. He gives me his, so what do you want me to do about it? Look. I say, look, and I show him how the side of my toe looks like the cracked open back of a cooked lobster. And I say, please, can I get a doctor's appointment? He cocks his head at me like a dog considering an odd noise. The pain is making it hard to work my program. I honestly think I could do better in the program if I have it taken care of, please. He considers this, sighs, and then walks me over to the nurse's folly without talking. He speaks to the nurse on shift in Samoan, faster and more complicated than I can follow, and she motions me to show her my feet. She takes my left foot in her hand and examines it, sucks in air through her teeth, clicks her tongue on the roof of her mouth, and then starts talking to Dwayne in Samoan. I catch the words doctor and apia. They're talking about taking me to a real doctor in the city. Dwayne turns his impenetrable black lenses on me and says, I don't want you to bother with me with this again. The nurse says, okay, I make appointment for you. When I ask when, she sucks air through her teeth again and says, "Hey!" before waving her hands at me and shooing me out with a torrent of frustrated Samoan, which I can only assume is invectives because I catch Valea Palangi in there somewhere, which means crazy foreigner or stupid white person, depending on the context. It's the end of May before my name gets called for a doctor run during the morning head count, which sounds like makala makala cervic, makala makala doctor run. The nurse tells me, to put on a nice shirt and a clean lava because we're going into a pia. I choose one of my newer shirts that hasn't had a chance to mildew too much yet. It's a rich purple. Why my mother would choose this other than to taunt me, I don't know. And it clashes with my yellow skirt. I look like a cross-dressing Lakers fan, but it's the best I can do. The ride to Apia, Western Samoa's capital and only city, located on the opposite side of the island, takes about an hour, and that's fine by me. I ask the nurse and the driver if I can untuck my shirt once we've left the beach, and they say yes, and the simple license, the small difference in appearance and the feel of fabric against my waist after having my shirt tucked into my lava for the last 8 months feels like a monumental freedom. Not having a towel over my head for the ride downtown, I can soak in the Samoan countryside and pretend I'm just some tourist on my way to the airport. When I think of the airport, I find myself just for a moment considering whether or not I could find a way to run away. To somehow find my way onto a plane, or maybe to the American Embassy, maybe when we get to Apia. But I stop because I realize that I don't stand a chance. I can barely run with the pain in my pus-dripping meatball toes, and I wouldn't have any idea where to go. When we near Apia, the driver pulls over at a small storefront and comes back to the van with a bunch of ice-cold sodas and glass bottles. I haven't had a carbonated beverage since the sleep deprivation night at Brightway, and when he pops one open and I hear it hiss and fizz, my heart goes funny and my posture straightens and he's handing it to me. That was, Brightway was like a year and a half ago. I somehow squeeze out thank you and the time it takes me to bring the bottle to my lips, but I think this guy already knew how thankful I'd be. He doesn't speak English at all, but I think he understands what a treat a soda is for any of us because he looks happy to watch me drink it. The bubbles effervesce all over my tongue and I hold them there and savor it for a second before I swallow the first sweet sip and realize it's been just as long since I've had a heavy dose of refined sugar or caffeine and suddenly I'm high, floating with chemicals my body forgot. And he hands me another. I'm double-fisting a Coke and Fanta. Fanta is really big in Samoa for some reason, and they have flavors here I've never even seen in the States, banana and lime. I shout up to him, Fale, Fafatai, Sale, Fafatai, Fafatai Lave. And he smiles at me in the rearview. When we get to the doctor, I'm all juiced up, and so what happens next seems more surreal than it already would. The hospital is an open-air building in downtown Apia, and the room where we're waiting for the doctor looks like it may double as an operating theater or maybe a morgue. There's a large steel table in the middle of the linoleum floor that does not look like it's the kind of thing used for checkups. The two walls that separate the room from the outside are made of the type of bricks with as much negative space as masonry, these in a floral pattern to create a semi-wall, a barrier that air can flow freely through. The doctor comes in, a short Asian man, and he and the nurse go back and forth in Samoan as he gestures to me and my foot. The nurse tells me to sit on the counter, not the table. I pop up on the counter that's running along the wall facing the street and feel the breeze on my back. Without saying hello to me or even making eye contact, the doctor grabs my left foot and examines my big toe briefly, then walks briskly out of the room. In a moment, he's back and carrying a large needle and syringe filled with a light amber fluid, liquid Novocaine. He brings a chair in front of me, sits, grabs my foot, and pulls it into his lap. Now he looks at me, cradling my ankle firmly in one hand, holding the large needle in the other. He motions with the needle towards my toe, and then he says, "Still, okay, still." I nod, and I'll hold still, and before I can prepare myself, he shoves the needle in between where the nail and the skin meet at the cuticle and depresses the plunger slightly so the skin immediately swells up to a very disturbing bubble, and I wince at the sharp sting of the needle followed by the intense chemical burn of the anesthetic. He very quickly makes another 4 injections following the horseshoe of the groove where the skin meets the nail. All of them sting sharp and then burn like acid, and with each one I scrunch up my face and inhale sharply through my clenched teeth, careful not to move. I can not only see but feel the skin being stretched by the liquid. It feels tight, like it might pop. But by the time he's plunged the needle in for the last time, the first spot is already starting to go a little numb, and now the skin around my nail is a U-shaped puff that looks entirely unnatural, like I've for some reason decided to Botox my toe. I think he's done, but there's still Novocaine left in the syringe, and just as I figure out where it's headed, he shoves the needle directly under the front of my nail into the nail bed, once, twice, 3 times. Pain is searing. He stands and drops my foot unceremoniously and says, "Wait, 5 minutes. And walks out of the room again. The nurse and I wait, but make no effort at small talk. I'm still squinting at the pain of the thing, and she seems content staring through the spaces in the brick. 5 minutes later, he comes back in, opens a drawer, pulls out what appears to be a completely ordinary non-medical reed, non-sterile pair of fine needle-nose pliers, sits back down, grabs my foot, my big toe now totally numb and deformed, and like he's attempting to pry up a particularly stubborn staple out of a hardwood floor, he wedges one jaw of the pliers under the front of my soon-to-be-his toenail, pushes in and back for maximum purchase, clamps down hard, wiggles a bit to test his grip, then yanks and rips the nail from my flesh with a sound like cracking open a lobster. The nail goes back further than I expect, deeper, and there is a pulling sensation inside my toe as the root first slides and then pops out with a sick crack, quickly followed by that little kissy sound that only 2 once-connected organic things separating from one another can make. The nail plate separating from the nail bed. And now the toenail that's been causing me so much pain is in the pliers in his hands on its way to the bin, and my toe looks alien and wrong, fleshy and vulnerable. I feel like I'm seeing a part of my body that I'm not supposed to see, like someone holding up your own heart to you. And now my toenail looks like a penis. And suddenly, I feel terribly sad, like I've lost something very important. I'm suddenly overwhelmed with the feeling that some irreversible change has happened in my body, and it will never be the same. I'm overcome with a deep regret for allowing some stranger to tear a piece of me off and throw it away. I know in my logical mind that this is what needed to happen unless I want to be in constant pain, but some other part of me feels as if I've made a terrible mistake. The doctor is already wrapping my bloody toe up in gauze. He prescribes me antibiotics to prevent infection, gives the prescription to the nurse. He says to me, "Keep clean, keep wrapped," and hands the nurse the rest of the roll of gauze. They speak a bit in Samoan, and when it's clear he's about to dart out of the room again for the final time, I say, "Fafatai lava, fomai, thank you, doctor." And he pauses long enough to finally look me in the eye in English and says, "Welcome." Then he's gone. On the way back to the beach, the driver stops and buys me another Coke. And I'm hoping that maybe he'll feel like stopping for some food too, but we left after breakfast and we're getting back before lunch, so probably not. Still, I'm happy for the Cokes and the ride and the fact that my toenail finally got treated after months. He only did one, though, the worst of the two. The other is still ingrown. I decide I'll live with it. On the road back to the beach, after we're back on our side of the island, away from the city and back to the smaller, more traditional villages, we pass a young Samoan woman bathing herself, and even though the nurse is with us and it's rude of me, I can't help but stare because I haven't seen a beautiful girl in almost a year. When we pull over at the cliffs above the beaches, I thank the driver again before climbing out of the van. As I retie my lava lava to tuck my shirt back in again, the freedom illusion I've been nurturing all day disappears, and with it, so does my mood. I limp back down the hill to Funga Beach, being ginger with my toe, but also going intentionally slow because I'm in no rush to get back, and somehow, on the way down, I manage to talk the nurse into excusing me from skills for an entire week. When we get back to the beach, she tells me to come see her once a day while my family is in one of their skills periods to take my antibiotic and have my gauze changed. It's almost like she's a real nurse. The nurses here are never this helpful. And I can only assume that I've either impressed her with my bravery in the face of large needles and skin bubbles and parts of me being ripped off, or inspired some pity in her by virtue of being 14 and small and in this place she must realize I don't belong in after spending a morning with me. I'll take either. By the time lunch rolls around, my toe is throbbing. For once, I actually want the Panadol they're always trying to throw at us as a panacea. I'm going to skip a bunch more, if you don't mind. And there's a section that I'm skipping where an investigative reporter comes to the program. And what they do is like a quick change where they put us, they give us Band-Aids to cover all our rashes and boils, and they hide all the kids who are really terrible looking, and they give us good food for a day, and then they bring someone down and trot them around. And so I skipped that part. And one day, with no warning, the tide sucks out all the way to the reef. It only takes a few minutes, but that's also how long it takes word to spread across the entire beach. Like a hole opened in the ocean somewhere, the water just disappears and leaves a seabed of dead coral and sea cucumbers and urchins and little floppy fish bare in the midday sun, stinking like a fish tank with a broken filter and an out-of-town owner. The sight of it is startling, like a brick floating in midair or a cat napping on a lily pad or someone carrying on a conversation while engulfed in flames. It just shouldn't be. And so the mind can't process it. But then the Samoans are telling everyone to get off the shore, to get above the retaining wall, to get in our follies. And the water rushes back all at once. It swallows the beach area, and the waves pound the retaining wall, slosh over it. The water is mighty and dark, angry and swollen. It's strange to see the ocean so much higher than it's ever been, when just minutes before it was like someone had pulled a drain plug somewhere in the middle of the Pacific. And I'm transfixed even as it threatens to swallow us. Part of me wants the water to keep coming, to consume us, to carry us out to sea. It rages against the shoreline, but rises no higher. Samoans say maybe there was an earthquake, maybe near Japan. But no one says how they were sure the water wouldn't come back as a wall to wash us all away. No one explains why we weren't evacuated off the beach to higher ground. And eventually, as it recedes, returns to normal, the surge leaves lots of work to be done. And the next few work projects are spent cleaning up the seaweed and reorganizing the rocks and sand, trying to arrange nature into something less natural, like trying to write on water. Thanks for listening to that. And to finish, so that we can all get back to our wine. That's what's important here. This is, yes, I'm going to read it out of you. This is super short. This is a piece of fiction. It's called After All of Our Apocalypses, Even After Every Armageddon. The phone in this fallout shelter won't work. I've been trying to get a dial tone for days, but the landline's been dead since everything went dark. The cell towers, the internet, the TV, they all went a while back, before the electricity, before the city went black. The generator's running out of gas, like the planet. We thought we had that problem solved with solar, and the panels would work if the sun wasn't blacked out by the bombs or the eruptions. Scientists think ISIS and Ebola are probably to blame for the zombies, and that it might all have something to do with the nukes Russia dropped and GMOs and vaccines. Near as anyone can tell, it went down like this. Climate change and global warming led to large swaths of land no longer being arable, and the sharp decline in agricultural yields caused the price of food to skyrocket. People flocked to the cities because there was a better chance of feeding their families. That's where the government was giving out aid rations. When there wasn't enough to go around, civil unrest broke out. The whole country went post-Katrina, rioting, looting. People protested the austerity measures and martial law and the curfew. But the response of militarized police and the National Guard was so swift and forceful that all dissent was quickly quelled. But then, illegal aliens carrying Ebola, terrorists who'd infected themselves with the virus, crossed the border, disguised as refugees seeking asylum from our airstrikes and immigrants coming here to steal free health care and welfare. Biochemical warfare up close and personal, sandwich artists sneezing on your 6-inch, commuters coughing on the subway, The first wave was suicided bullet bombers, but suddenly anyone under the weather was an unwitting accomplice of the IS. With everyone concentrated in population centers, the plague was uncontrollable. After months and months of going without fresh fruit or vegetables, of eating wheat rations and meat pump full of antibiotics, our entire country was left immunocompromised. Everyone walking around overweight and weak and tired, feeling that feeling you get right before you get sick only all the time. And so the epidemic washed over every city in waves. The Soviets, spooked about being next, split an atom over every major metropolis and declared a quarantine to isolate the outbreak. Geologists believe fracking in the Rockies combined with the payload Putin dropped on Denver is what triggered the supervolcano under Yellowstone. We haven't seen the sun since. The CDC speculates radiation from the blast catalyzed a heretofore unrecognized reaction between a component found in many common vaccines and a chemical byproduct of the agricultural methods used in growing GMO wheat. Presto, Geiger emitting Ebola zombies, puking and shitting irradiated infectious necro waste, eating anything and anyone they can find before they fall over to become biohazardous landmines. The only survivors now navigate the perpetual dismal dusk of a dead and decaying society. The fetid stench of a rotting and rancid civilization filling our every breath, we search for canned food from one safe house to the next, hoping to come into contact with any other immunes not carrying the virus, but hopefully carrying some Spam or Chef Boyardee. I've been holed up here for days, trying to call anyone, anywhere, to figure out where to head next. But the landlines went with the electricity. I've already siphoned every gas tank around that isn't a diesel, and now the generator's almost out of gas, and I'm down to my last two tins of Hormel. Sitting on a half-collapsed wall, watching the last lights on the horizon go as the grid finally gives out the last gasp of our once great nation, my reverie is interrupted by a ringing. The phone. I rush down the ladder and lunge for the receiver. Hello? Hello, this is American Education Services calling on behalf of Sally Mae with an important message about your student loans. Thank you all for coming. Please drink and have fun.
No, you don't get away that easily.
Oh. Well, someone please get me a drink.
I think we all need a drink after that. That was.
Thank you, Papa.
That was amazing. Thank you very much for sharing with us. And I think I can speak for everyone. That is not something we will forget probably ever. And I hope you come back when the book's published and we'll do a reading right here, because it's just amazing that you started here and you're reading your reading here, and we need to have a book party here as well, don't you think? Yes. And we have time for a few questions, if anybody has a specific question they'd like to ask JC, or you can ask him quietly afterwards if you'd rather. Yeah.
So as far as like really like collecting those awful memories, how did you go about, you know, piecing together the details? You know,
I wrote the book over a period of years. So I started it here almost a decade ago, and I wrote it while I was also pursuing an undergraduate and then a graduate degree. And thankfully, because of the advent of the internet and Facebook, there popped up a lot of survivors forums. Where people were able to exchange their memories, and I have a pretty good memory. It was just more about the act of having to cull from it. It took a long time, but it was just a lot of sitting at the desk and letting myself go to that place. Yeah.
JC.
Yo.
If it's not a spoiler.
Sure.
How did you graduate? You're rehabilitated.
How did
you get out?
I think it's cute that you think I'm rehabilitated. I did not actually graduate the program, though that is the terminology. Typically, you would work your way up to level 4. You would become staff. Then you would supervise other people. And then you would work your way out. Once you're on level 3, you can be a family leader where you're in charge of a group of 10 to 15 boys. And you're the one running their exercise, the skills sessions, and you're the one running the family meetings where we give each other feedback, which is this sort of daily reification of the seminar. Thank you, buddy. So I got to level 3, and I was a family leader, and I was running family meetings and facilitating all of that feedback, and I was running the skill sessions. So I was basically complicit in the abuse and torture and brainwashing of other people, and I just didn't like it or myself when I was doing that. So I went to the shift leader, and I handed in my red lava, which connoted level 3, and asked for a yellow one. And they were like, what the fuck are you doing? And that had never been done before. And I said, I'm dropping myself to level 1. I don't want to do this anymore. I'm just going to stay here until my mother decides to bring me home. And so they put me in isolation for 3 days. And then when I got out, I was in a shotgun circle, which is you're in the center of everyone during a family meeting, and they're all yelling hurtful, hateful things at you. And then I was ostracized for a month, which means no one talks to you and you're not allowed to talk. And so I went through this period of being kind of punished for it. And then I just engaged in passive noncompliance for like another 14 months. Something like that, because I had been there about a year and a half at that point. So I was there 2 years total. So it, no, maybe like basically that when that happened at 14 months, and then whatever the rest of 2 years is, I just another 10. So finally, my mother decided to bring me home, not because I wasn't working the program, but because she was getting married. She got married 2 days after I got back in the country. So.
Said this, but do you have any contact with any of these people?
You said you saw the chart. So do you mean the program, or do you mean the like other kids I was there with?
The kids already.
Yeah, Facebook is amazing for that. So there are one of the sort of climactic moments in the book is actually a reunion in Las Vegas, Nevada, where coincidentally I got kidnapped. But it was a central place that's cheap hotels and stuff. So it was a bunch of kids from Samoa got together. We're all grown up now. So I attended that actually while I was in the middle of, I was writing the book. So I was in grad school, and this was my thesis. Say again. No, but so... Here's a crazy story. The grad school I went to is Goddard College, and it's known for kind of being a hippie college. And one of my friends there is like a shaman. She's a poet who studied at Reed and Oxford, but she also, she was a rock star in the 80s, played with Joan Jett. Her name is Susan Lynch. You can look up her album cover. It's kind of cool. But she practices as a shaman, and she came to me and was like, hey, I heard from my spirit guides you're doing this thing. And I was like, oh, yeah, I'm doing that thing. So she was like, they want to give you protection. So I was like, okay, I'll take it. She encased me in turquoise and silver and, sent me with her spirit guide, and I was going there anyway, but I went to Las Vegas. And so I went to the airport where I had been kidnapped, and I went to the information desk, and I was like, hey, where would the parking garage have been in 1996? And she was like, oh, it's employee parking now, but it's over there. And technically you're not supposed to go there, but if you take this elevator. So I went up there. And I went to find like the spot I was kidnapped from, and I found it. But some cops found me, because these days when you walk around an airport in a place you're not supposed to be, people get weirded out. So four cops converged on my location, and I had to explain to them like, "Oh, I'm just here because I was kidnapped here once," and they were really cool about it. They just escorted me out. Steve.
Does one of the later chapters in your book include your feelings toward your parents afterwards?
It's kind of something I tease out the whole way through. I mean, that's kind of for me. The book has a lot of narrative tension pulling the reader through, but personally, I think when we write a book, we're all trying, especially a memoir, we're all trying to work through something. What I was trying to work through was like, how can a mother make those decisions? And I was looking for empathy. It does.
And when do you anticipate it becoming available?
I hope next year sometime, but publishing world is glacial, so. I work with Betsy Amster, though we haven't signed a contract. We're just kind of informal and friends, and she wants the book, but we'll see. So if you have another agent.
We can have buyers in this room.
Yes. Okay. We can pre-sell it if you'd like.
Yeah, sure. Awesome.
A lot of what you're describing in the book sounds like the cultish, like Scientology
Warren Earhart was good friends with L. Ron Hubbard. Yeah. Yeah. I'll get. Yep.
You talked about how you've been doing this for many years now, and I myself have been working on my memoir for quite a few years. How would you say the tone of your writing has changed as you kind of process this nonfiction material? Because when I started, it was like, and then as it's come along, which tone has changed?
Well, that was a really weird thing being here because I was working to revise material I had written so long ago. And so it was a challenge to bring like the way I write now to, you know, a place that seemed uniform with the way I was writing then. And I guess the way I was writing then was just a little more overwrought because you couldn't tell. thanks, Thor. Caught that. Now, I would say that these days, the stuff I write that's new, because this material is old, and so and it's written from the perspective of a 13-year-old slash adult, and it's kind of telling that line. But I'd say these days I write with a much more reserved tone, and then it was much more emotional, which is, I think, but that's kind of mirrored the way I think most art has progressed from, I mean, we went from Dashboard Confessional to like shots. We're out of the emo phase. Yes.
Josh. Me? Oh, yeah. You kind of half answered this question with him, but maybe this will be in the book, and I should just wait until it's published. But I just was wondering, what was the conversation like with your parents when you finally got out? You told them, do you realize what you just did to me for the past 2 years or put me through?
Yeah, no, they still don't. To be clear, my father died when I was very young. So he passed away when I was like 2.5. Any onus belongs to my mother. She didn't really want to hear about it or talk about it at all. And that persisted mostly until like 3 months ago. She doesn't really still. There have been since a number of other books that have been written in general about institutionalized coercive persuasion. There's a book called Straightling by Cindy Drew Etler, which was about Straight Incorporated in the 70s. There's a book by Julia Shears called Jesus Land about Escuela Caribe, which was a Dominican or a Christian reform school in the Dominican Republic, not nearly as punitive, but also pretty harsh. And there was a book by Maya Shalovitz, an investigative journalist, called Help at Any Cost, which how the troubled teen industry hurts parents and, you know, cons parents and hurts kids. And so I have tried to present to her, like, this isn't just me. This is like, you know, but she just doesn't, because it would make. Yeah, she doesn't. It's not going to. It's so like 6 months ago, I was trying to tell her like some new piece of information I found. And I was saying something. She was like, you deserved it. And that was just, that's my mom. And, I think that she would be too, like, it would be too much guilt for her, you know? Like, she would feel too much. So she can't process that. So, we just don't talk about it, mostly. Yeah.
So you're not just an author, but you're also a stand-up comic. Can you discuss how the writing process, the creative process, differs between the two?
Yes.
Your observation on both, and your writing has a lot of dark humor in it, and your stand-up comedy has a lot of dark humor in it.
Thank you for noticing. The writing process differs mostly in the drugs I take. No, I would say that writing comedy is something I do communally. Like I bounce it off a lot of people, and I'm not afraid to share it like while I'm working on it, because that helps me craft it. But this stuff I probably like write on my own and keep it away from people for a very long time and don't feel comfortable showing it to people ever at all. I work on privately until I am forced to bring it to a public room.
Forced you.
Okay, yeah.
And we are grateful that you opened up and read that to us. And for real, I mean, you get yourself down here with your book and we'll take care of everything else. It's a deal, all right? Yeah. Thank you very much.